So this is a little follow-on film from the one we did last week, the filing of the seppa and crenellating the edges. A couple of questions were sent my way. I'd like to address them now rather than in the comments sections on YouTube. The first question that a couple of you asked was, how do I ensure that the spacing that I marked out with the dividers on the edge, how do I ensure that when I get to the end, I meet the point and there isn't a discrepancy? So there's a couple of ways to go about this. And one of the commenters on YouTube, I apologize, I don't remember your name offhand, gentleman from Russia, I think it was, mentioned this method. And it is, in fact, what I would do. Would this be a problem? So we're going to mark out along this line, just so you can see. So this is 3 centimeter length. And I think I've got a roughly about a 2.5 millimeter gap. So I'm going to mark these out now, put my divider in the hole. This is hard doing it, keeping my head out of the way. So I get it in the previous hole and mark it, move along, mark it, pop it in there. Give it a click when it gets in place. It's a lot easier when you don't have a camera in your own view. So I'm marking these out. So I'm doing this large so you can see it. You can imagine, obviously, on a seppa it would be much smaller. Get to the end. And there's a dot waiting for me at the end, which in theory would be my end point. Now, obviously, we're not going to get there because I set this up so it wouldn't get in place. So we can then figure out how to correct this. So here we've got a discrepancy. It's about 1.5 millimeters, maybe 2 millimeters discrepancy, which we now have to split the difference going back. So I'm going to go back, starting here. Now this looks a bit messy at this point because the gaps are much bigger. On a seppa or small scale, these gaps are much smaller. So the point is, the correct position is midway between here. So there's your actual point. And there's your actual point. So by doing this on a small scale, the last 2 or 3 centimeters of your seppa, you can space them out and you can lose that discrepancy. It looks a bit complicated here, but actually on a smaller scale, it makes far more sense. Okay? Another question was asked. The face of the seppa that the habaki sits on, that would obviously be seen when the sword is drawn, that face, oftentimes it's not decorated, it's simply left polished flat. I tend to apply a decorative finish to it, and it's a technique that you may find useful in all sorts of circumstances. So what I use is I use a coarse cut, I think this is a number 2 coarse cut hand file, that has got a safety edge, a smooth safety edge, right? Now, if you don't have one, you can always grind one on or you can polish one on. And then what you do, you use the corner, the safety edge up against your thumb as you're holding the piece to guide. And you hold, the whole of the file is resting on the face of the copper. And simply moving up and down, using that corner, and using my thumb to push it along, and we get this striated finish. Now you can see there are gaps. It's very light. It's not a particularly deep. You can go a little deeper if you want a more sort of textured finish, and I shall do that now. And I'm using my thumb just to guide the piece along, the file along the face. And I can have a look where it's not catching, and I can bring the file in there, touch it, and you can see how it's starting to look a little bit like scoured wood or a really, really heavy rain shower. I'm going to do that whole section. Now I can go up to the edge. I'm just gently controlling the file. So I'm just pushing against my thumb and I can move across the piece. So I make sure I'm really covering the metal. And it's a very light touch at this point. I'm just creating a texture, and I can go back and put little deeper grooves here and there. And so it would look a little bit like a piece of wood. The effect really does depend on a nice regular effect, nice and even. You're not trying to just create a rough file finish. You're simulating wood, as I say, or rain. So there we have it. It might be a little bit rough, and at this point I shall reveal one of my secret weapons. This is a steel brush. It's quite a fine one. I've been using this for about 20 odd years, and it's looking a bit knackered, but it's done a lot of work and it's really handy. So these are quite fine, quite firm. You can see they're bent over and they're a little bit squishy. So I can go along the line here, and what it does is it gives it a little bit of a burnish, but not enough to obliterate the pattern, and it's getting rid of any burrs. How's that? Fancy, huh? Worth getting one of these. All sorts of uses, and I'll show you another one in a moment. So just to make things clear again, we're going to do a little bit of fighting on this face. Different view now, so you can see what I would be seeing more like. As you can see, the file is roughly 45 degrees to the surface of the metal. So if I was filing flat, it'd be like that. So I'm using this corner, safety edge up against my thumb, and it's there. So I'm literally using that. You could use a triangular needle file, but I find this is far more effective. A triangular needle file tends to eat away your thumb, actually. But so we're moving along here, just stroking. It does help if the piece of metal you're filing is flat. Otherwise, you'll end up with dips. You can see, now I'm going to use my thumb to gently nudge it along. And I see some gaps, so I come back and just put a bit of pressure where I see some gaps. Over here, there's some gaps, so I'm just going to concentrate there a little bit. Just maintaining the direction is roughly in the same kind of line, really. I want my effect to be nice and even. I can come across here, just using my thumb again. Now I'm just relaxing my thumb and letting the file move down across the plate, so moving this way. You could go back and forth, it's not, but here I'm lifting it and I'm touching. It's quite a light touch to get a nice even finish. So I would recommend doing a nice even finish all over and then going back and putting in some deeper lines if you wanted. The reason for that is if you put in deep lines to start with, it makes it very difficult to make a nice even coverage because your file tends to want to keep jumping into those grooves you've made. So get a nice even, almost satin directional finish. And then, as I say, you can go back and put a little bit more pressure and give yourself some wood grain effect. There we have it. Another question I was asked was how I finish the crenellations. I realized the film didn't really discuss the final polish. Now, you've got a little scallop piece, and you've got a little piece underneath that's been filed. I used these little escarpment files. This is their number 6 cuts. They're really rather fine. These are Grobe Velour escarpment files. The finish on the inside here is really rather fine. And you'll remember from the film, I ran this over just to soften the edges. right? So this is obviously much coarser than fine emery, but it's still a rather fine finish. So what I did in the film, or on the seppa that you saw, I finished with a wire brush. I'm using the stainless steel wire brush. You could use a brass brush as well. Try saying that quickly. To give you a sort of a burnished finish. So using the brass brush just across the face. Now, this is a seppa that a student made in my studio some time ago. So it's got a bit of tarnish on it. So just going across with this fine stainless steel brush, it's caught everything nice and bright. And then as a last touch, using a burnisher, steel burnisher, I rub gently along and catch all the high spots. And for me, that creates quite a nice, just using the narrow edge of the burnisher there just to catch. It creates a nice contrast and articulates the surface nicely. Now you can, if you wanted to, you could take fine emery paper, fold it in half, and work gently in those grooves. You could really get pedantic about it. You could cut a little piece of scotch stone. Similarly, you could polish these out. You could take this up to a bright finish if you wanted to. Depends how much time you want to expend or how much time you've got, and how patient you are. But that's what I did, and it's an approach I generally take. You could also take a stiff brush, not a toothbrush. I find the teeth on toothbrushes are a little bit too thick. This is a stiff, I don't know what the hair is, but it's a natural bristle brush. And you could use your polishing compound. I would recommend doing it on a piece of wood and polishing it. So you'd polish it like that, a bit like when you polish generally. And you can affect quite a good polish on the surface of those scalloped edges. But that's how I finished mine.